Hey, good morning, GCDC. This is Pastor Art Battle and all of our supporters. Just want to thank you guys for tuning in for this teaching, our foundation of the kingdom this Sunday, as God will bless us to be able to give him praise, honor, and glory through what it is that we're going to talk about. And this Sunday, we're going to actually be looking at kind of a statement, and it goes, "All rise, here comes the judge." And so we're going to be focused in two different sets of scriptures this morning. The first is in Matthew 7, verses 1 through 2. And then the second is John 5, 22 to 30. But before we get started with that, I want to make sure that we have a word of prayer and just ask God to bless this teaching as only he can. So let's bow our heads, close our eyes. Father God, we come right now giving you praise, honor, and glory, thanking you for blessing us with this awesome Sunday. Father, we ask right now that you anoint and touch this, your son, this teacher of your word this hour. Bless God as only you can and teach your word with power and pour yourself through this earthen vessel. God, help us understand that Jesus is the judge that you have appointed and that you will bless each of us to live a life, hopefully, that is worthy and acceptable unto him. But God, its judgment is in your power and not ours. And you author and authorize us to be able to do your good and perfect will according to how it is that you will bless. So God, I ask right now that you bless every person that is watching. Bless this, your teacher. But God, bless and teach this word with power. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're going to look at in Matthew. Before we get to Matthew, I want to do a quick definition on what it means to judge. And this is something that a lot of times we, sometimes even inside the household of faith, have some issues regarding whether or not we're judging a situation appropriately. Or sometimes individuals feel as if you are judging them when you provide the word of God to them. But what this definition covers is actually a Greek word that judge actually means. And so it says to separate, choose, approve, or prefer. It also means to pronounce an opinion of right and wrong. It means to be summoned to trial, that one's case may be examined and judgment passed upon it. It means to preside over with the power of giving judicial decisions, prerogative of kings and rulers to pass judgment. It also means having a lawsuit. So this particular word in the Greek, judge, where we look at all these various things that it means, a lot of times we look at, you know, different television shows that might have a judge, like Law and Order or things of that nature, where you have a judge that sits at the bench and, you know, performs their duty and being able to ensure that a trial or case comes to conclusion, that a jury gets the facts and is able to be provided with evidence, follow certain rules of procedure, all those kind of things. And for me as an attorney, there's an aspect of where, you know, I've been in different courtrooms at different times. And when the judge is about to come in, the bailiff then would announce, you know, "All rise, here comes the judge." And so there's this piece here in the scripture verses that we're going to look at, that there's only one judge and his name is Jesus. And we're going to look at in Matthew where it tells us not to judge, because if we do, it actually puts judgment on ourselves. But then in John, it's going to break down how God has appointed Jesus to be the judge, to be the individual that gives eternal life-giving power and can judge according to God's will, not man's will. So we're going to look here quickly, and we'll look at Matthew 7, verses 1 through 2 in the New Living Translation. And in these verses, it says, "Do not judge others, and you will not be judged, for you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged." Now, I want us to think about that as how God blesses us to have a greater understanding of what it means to actually judge. We broke down the definition, and I'll go back just quickly. What Matthew was instructing us and giving us a definition or an understanding of is that we're not supposed to be the individual who pronounces an opinion of right and wrong. That's solely in the hands of Jesus. That's solely in the hands of God. That's solely done through conviction by the Holy Spirit. And then it says to be summoned to trial that one's case may be examined and judgment passed upon it. We don't sit in the seat where we could judge somebody else. So when we look at Matthew 7 verses 1 through 2, we shouldn't be sitting in a seat where we're judging individuals. where we're determining or have an opinion of right and wrong. We should be looking at the Word of God, and the Word of God blesses us to have an understanding of right and wrong. And none of us have the ability or the authority to preside over other individuals with power of giving judicial decisions unless you are an actual judge. But in this regard, you can never sit in the seat that Jesus is sitting in, because he's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And there's only one seat where he has the ability to provide the judgment that God wants him to provide. So when we look at Matthew 7, 1 and 2, it's telling us definitively that we are not to judge others. We can't sit in that seat of judgment in that way. And sometimes in our lives, we've judged individuals and judged poorly or wrongly or looked down upon individuals because we've either puffed ourselves up or have levels of pride or self-elevation that have nothing to do with Almighty God. We lack sometimes humility, and we don't look at, if we're judging somebody else by a particular standard, then we're going to be judged by the same standard by which we judge that other person. But it says, do not judge others, and you will not be judged. Now, I want to share something here which becomes a little bit of a differing aspect. What we need to be able to understand is that when somebody shares scripture with you, when somebody shares what the Bible says, when somebody shares what God instructs us through the Bible and how God blesses us to see Jesus and his life and the things that he did, also through the empowerment of the Holy Spirit dwelling on the inside, when they share that and there's a level of conviction that the Holy Spirit brings, that's not judgment by that person. That's God blessing. That's the Holy Spirit coming in. That's Jesus then allowing him as the Word to penetrate areas of our lives that need to be changed. But here it says, for you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged. And so if you get to the position where you want to sit in a seat and wind up looking down on other people, or you want to sit in a seat of judgment and try to cast doubt or have an opinion of right and wrong, or to say to yourself that you have the power and authority to render a judicial decision, that you're going to be judged by the exact same standard. And so you got to watch yourself and how it is that you conduct yourself. You have to make sure that you're doing the things that God will bless you to do in the ways that he will bless you to do it, so you're not sitting in a seat that doesn't have your name on it. When you enter into a courtroom, in the gallery, that's where everybody sits who's not a part of the actual trial. Many times there's a divider, and then you have to go past that divider, and then you have the attorneys along with their clients who'll be sitting in those seats that'll be facing the actual judge and the bench in which the judge is sitting. And then either to the left or the right, you'll then have the jury stand, where you'll have individuals who are here to witness the witnesses and the testimony and evaluate the evidence to determine if the defendant is guilty or not, or whatever kind of way the case is going to be adjudicated. So when you look at all of these things, there's only one seat where the judge actually sits. No one sits in the judge's seat except the judge. And so whether you're a witness, whether you're providing testimony, whether you're an attorney, whether you're a plaintiff, whether you're a defendant, whether you're an outside bystander who's coming in just to witness the actual trial, whatever it is, not even the bailiff or the court reporter sit in the judge's seat. There's only one who sits at the bench. There's only one who has the gavel. There's only one that can render a judicial decision, and that's the judge. And so when we look at this in Matthew 7, 1 through 2, God is telling us very definitively, don't try to sit in a seat that's not for you to sit in. Don't judge other people, because then you set a standard by which you're going to be judged by Jesus, according to what the Word of God is going to share with us in John 5, where it's going to help us be able to see what it is that God is going to bless us to be able to discern and how the Holy Spirit will touch in this way. So when we get here now to John 5, verses 22 to 30, this is where we see this aspect of where God is going to bless. And in that phrase that we use at the beginning, all rise, here comes the judge, we're actually going to see an aspect of where the power of Jesus Christ is even going to raise the dead from being dead to rise again and to have eternal life with him, just because of the power that he has, which is an eternal life-giving power. So in verse 22, it says, and in addition, the Father judges no one. Instead, he has given the Son absolute authority to judge, So what that means is that it's not that God is the one who's providing the judgment. It's that Jesus has been given the authority, the absolute authority from God to judge in the manner in which God wants Jesus to judge. Jesus has come here to earth, wrapped in flesh, the incarnate aspect of God, to be able to do the things that God is blessing him to be able to do. So when we read about these things in the Bible, God blessed us to be able to see that Jesus actually came and did all the things that God had called for him to be able to do while he was here on earth. Now, he was still yet God, still the Holy Spirit was present, so the Trinity was always intact. But there's an aspect of where God gives something just to Jesus that he never gives to man. He gives to Jesus the ability to do what? To have absolute authority to judge in the ways that God wants him to judge. He gives him the absolute authority to be able to separate or to choose or to prefer or to approve or to make a judicial decision regarding the right and wrong of a situation. He leaves that to Jesus, the omniscient one, the all-powerful one, the one who has absolute wisdom to be able to provide what? Absolute judgment or absolute authority and give judgment according to how God will bless. So then in verse 23, it says, so that everyone will honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Anyone who does not honor the Son is certainly not honoring the Father who sent him. Now, this is the thing that's interesting about this as God is blessing, and we kind of get a little bit deeper into this. When we look at the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, they're all one. But in this instance where we're having John provide us with insight, and God is blessing Jesus to be able to give us greater insight into what it is that actually judging means and how it is that God blessed Jesus to have absolute authority to judge. He's saying here that there's a level of honor that we provide to Jesus. And in doing that, we actually provide honor to the Father. And so when we honor Jesus, when we give God, Jesus the praise, honor, and glory that he so rightfully deserves, then that's also us giving the Father, who is still a part of Jesus and the Holy Spirit, that's us giving the Father the same level of honor, the same level of respect, and the same level of praise that we're supposed to, the same level of glory that we're supposed to as we do to the Son. So it says, so that everyone will honor the Son just as they honor the Father. And anyone who does not honor the Son is certainly not honoring the Father who sent him. So I want us to understand something here, that during this time frame, there were individuals who were trying to split this aspect of God being separate from Jesus as the Son. And to say Jesus was just a good man, or Jesus, you know, kind of walked the earth but did maybe some miracles, that kind of thing. But we don't really know if he's the Son of God. See, here there's an affirmation that Jesus makes where he says anyone who does not honor the Son, it's certainly not honoring the Father who sent him. And so the honoring of Jesus, the aspect of giving your life over to him, submitting to Jesus and making him Lord and Savior of your life, then also provides what? Honor to the Father, because it's the Father who sent Jesus into the world. And so we need to realize that we need to make sure that we respect God the Father, we honor God the Father, we honor Jesus the Son, and we honor and respect the Holy Spirit. And so in all of that, what this is helping us be able to see is that we need to make sure that we're honoring Jesus. Like, a lot of times there's aspects in our lives we do things that are dishonorable as relates to our relational connection with God through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Like, we shouldn't go around saying negative things about Christ or other believers or tearing down the household of faith, those kind of things. We should be able to look at what God blesses in his word and be able to support and lift up those that need help and support. And that's a way in which we provide honor and respect, not just to Jesus, but also to Father. Because if we're truly going to be followers of Jesus, disciples of Jesus, mathetes of Jesus, the students of Jesus who live our lives according to how it is that he will bless us to live them, we know that 1 John 2:6 tells us that whoever claims to live in him must walk as what? As Jesus did. Jesus always honored the Father. Therefore, we should honor Jesus. And in honoring Jesus, we will then what? Absolutely honor the Father. So we get here to verse 24. It says, I tell the truth, those who listen to my message and believe in God who sent me have eternal life. They will never be condemned for their sins, but they have already passed from death into life. So this becomes a huge concept for us as believers, where Jesus is saying that if you have listened to his message and believe in God who sent him into the earth, then you already have eternal life. So what does the Roman road tell us? we sometimes will recite this to individuals. If you believe that Jesus, you know, if you look at your life and say to yourself, you know, I need to accept Jesus as Lord over my life, then you are able to say that you accept Jesus as Lord over your life. And then you believe in your heart. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you're what? You're saved. This is confirmation of that right now. He's telling us the truth that if we listen to that message, if we listen to the messages all about God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit and the things that God had blessed many of those in the Bible to be able to do, and we believe in God who sent Jesus into the earth, then we already have eternal life. That means that the minute that you accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you grasp and have eternal life right now. That this fleshly body will die at some point in time, that it will return to the dust and ashes from which it was formed. But then after that, you'll have eternal life with God the Father. Because it says that we will never be condemned, what, for our sins? Because what? When we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of our lives, we're a brand new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And so when you look at that and get even deeper into that, you'll begin to realize that we are blessed to be able to live a sinless life because the person who took on all the sin, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, blessed us to be able to take on the sins of the entire world and then was crucified, which was the perfect sacrifice that God required in order to right the relationship between man and himself. And so, but what we've done in that regard, because we were living or walking dead at that point before we accepted Christ, we move where? We move from passing from death to what? To life in Christ Jesus. We move from passing from death in the world to living what? An awesome eternal life in God the Father through Jesus Christ the Son and the power of what? The Holy Spirit. Get into verse 25. It says, "And I assure you that the time is coming, indeed is here now, when the dead will hear my voice, the voice of the Son of God, and those who listen will live." So this is a huge aspect here where Jesus is blessing and saying, listen, that there's a time, that there's a time that's coming, and the time that's coming is right now. This is the present moment. This is the urgency. This is the aspect of where the climactic time that we are living in right now, where we get the opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and to change our very lives, to move from the aspect of where we are dead, not hearing the voice of God, and then move to the place where the dead will hear what? God's voice, Jesus Christ's voice. And then it says the voice of the Son of God. So we will hear Jesus himself, the message of Jesus. And then all of us who listen will do what? Will live. You got to watch what it is that you pour into your ear gates. You have to watch what it is that you allow your eye gates to visualize. The reason that these things become important is because these are portals into your very spirit and your soul. And so as a result, you have these aspects of things that you allow to be inundated into your body, into your soul, into your spirit, into your psyche, into your mind, into your speech, into your life. And so what Jesus is saying here, he says, listen, you need to hear my voice. This is the thing about Jesus' sheep, that the sheep know the shepherd's voice. And so as a result, there has to be a point in time where you know the voice of God. You know the voice of Jesus. You've been empowered by the Holy Spirit, and you know how to hear that still small voice that will tell you, you have eternal life in me, that will share with you, you have an awesome way to be able to live your life for me as long as you follow my word and do my thing, do all the things that I'm commanding you to do according to my good and perfect will. We get here now to verse 26 and 27. It says, the Father has life in himself, and he has granted that same life-giving power to his Son, and he has given him authority to judge everyone because he is the Son of Man. So I want to share this with you and break this down as God blesses. There's a huge piece here where God blesses us to have a greater understanding of what it is that he's actually granting and giving to Jesus. That there's a relational connection that God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and the Holy Spirit have that is unbreakable. It's a bond that's always been, and it's a bond that will always be. And so as a result, there's a relational connection that God the Father and Jesus Christ the Son have where Jesus receives what? Life-giving power from Almighty God because he is the Son of God. He is God himself, but he's the incarnate aspect of the Son of God given to us to be able to live our lives and to pattern our lives after what Jesus did for each of us here on this earth and being sacrificed, but also the miracles that he did, the way that he taught us how to pray, the things that he taught us about fasting, the ways that he taught us how to honor the Father. All these things are contained in the Word. And so when we look at this, it says the Father has life in himself. So the Father is self-sustaining and self-sufficient in the life that he is, because he's the Trinity already, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. But in that, he's now given what? He's now granted a level of power to Jesus. I want you to think about this. And then Jesus grants what? A level of power to us as believers, because when we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, become embowed, imbued with, and then receive the totality of the Holy Spirit on the inside, and then it dwells with us because we are the what? The temple of the Holy Spirit that's residing on the inside. Then that's a transference of a level of power that God wants us to have through our faith and belief in Jesus Christ. And says he is given what? Jesus, authority to judge everyone. Why? Because he is the Son of Man, because he's in right relationship with God, because he is the Son of God, and because of their relationship and the unbreakable bond that they have. Then he says, Jesus, I want you now, son, to judge everything. You're going to judge everyone because you're perfect. That's why we as imperfect people can't sit in a level of judgment over other people. A lot of things that are happening in the United States right now, got Supreme Court justices, federal justices on the bench, all the rest of that. All these individuals try to govern according to the rule of law that's been presented to them, the precedents that have already been set, the history of law, what things will impact people in either good or bad ways, all those kind of things. But all of those individuals, I don't care how great they are, they're still imperfect because we are imperfect beings. And so as a result, God says, I'm not going to leave the judgment of my people, the judgment of those who are going to have eternal life with me, to somebody who's imperfect. I'm not going to leave it to somebody who might have ulterior motives. I'm not going to leave it to someone who might have somebody in their pocket, or might be receiving certain incentives, or might have some kind of biased or discriminatory view of somebody else. At the end of the day, what God does with Jesus Christ, he says, listen, you are the perfect individual who provided the sacrifice, but you're also the perfect individual who has the greatest wisdom and knowledge, because you are all knowing, because you are my son and you are a part of me, to be able to judge every single person. See, that's why we can't sit in a seat of judgment, because it's not a seat that we're ever supposed to sit in. We're supposed to be able to give individuals the word of God, allow the conviction of the Holy Spirit to do its work, but then just provide the scripture and let the scriptures do its work. At the end of the day, we need to be able to say to ourselves, are we living the way that God wants us to live? Because there's life-giving power that we can only receive through Jesus Christ. And once we receive that power from Jesus Christ, it should empower us to be able to do what? To live the right way. To be able to do the things that would be right in the sight of Almighty God, and not to do the things that are wrong in the sight of Almighty God through Jesus Christ. So let's get here now to 28. It says, don't be surprised. Indeed, the time is coming when all the dead in their graves will hear the voice of God's Son. And then in verse 29, it says, and they will rise again. Those who have done good will rise to experience eternal life, and those who have continued in evil will rise to experience judgment. So I want you to understand something that we talked about at the very beginning. That when individuals enter into, when the judge then comes into the courtroom, all those, both the gallery, the jury, the individuals who are sitting there, witnesses, bailiff, whoever might be in the court at that time, the bailiff says this, the bailiff says, all rise. And as a result, when the bailiff says, all rise, every person that is in that particular courtroom then stands to their feet. And then when the judge then sits down, then what occurs is then everybody else may be seated. And the judge many times will say, you may be seated. And then as a result, everybody else then gets seated, because the judge has what? Ultimate authority and power in the courtroom in which he or she is the judge for that particular court. And so there might be various courtrooms inside of a building. Like if you go down to Toledo Municipal Court, or go down to Lucas County Court of Common Pleas, all those, there'll be various courtrooms throughout an entire building. But this is the thing. There's only one courtroom. There's only one judge. There's only one judge in the kingdom of Almighty God, and that is Jesus Christ. And what he says here in verse 28, he says, don't be surprised. The time is coming when all the dead in their graves will hear what? The voice of God's Son, will hear Jesus Christ. Now, these are individuals who have passed. They will hear the voice of Jesus Christ, and watch what happens. When they hear the voice of Jesus Christ in 29, it says, and they will rise again. Those who have done good will do what? Will rise to experience eternal life. So once you've now passed, you've sealed and concluded what it is that you've done here on the earth. Your temporal time is up, and now we're looking at what's going to happen for your eternal time. See, when a person dies, that's not the end of the story. There's an aspect of where the physical man now is no longer present. However, the spiritual man still has a level of judgment that only Jesus can mete out in order to be able to discern or determine where it is that they are going to spend all of eternity. Now, what it is that you've done during your temporal time frame will impact, will have a direct consequence, will be probably the sole aspect of where it is that your soul is going to come to rest, and you're going to spend all of eternity either in a good place, which is those who have done good will rise to experience eternal life with God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and the Holy Spirit in heaven, or and those who have continued in evil will rise to experience what? Judgment, which means that they will go to the other place, which means that they will not go to heaven, that they will go into eternal darkness, which would mean separation from Almighty God. And so when we look at this, this becomes an aspect of a life and death decision that we make here on earth, that we have to have the opportunity and the ability to understand that we could mess around and say all these things and think that all these other things are going to happen, but this is a real aspect for God's people. And we need to realize that for us, we're called when we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior to live a life that is worthy of the name of being a child of Almighty God. When we start to look at the depths of what it is that God is blessing us to see, he's telling us that if you are an individual who has done good, you will rise to experience eternal life. Now, with that doing good, that also means that you've accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And those who have continued in evil will rise to experience judgment. I got to say this. It was kind of cool today as God blessed. And it ties into what it is that God is blessing this message this Sunday to be about. On Friday, I was blessed to be able to go down to the Lucas County courthouse to be able to file some documentation with the probate court. And so I'm going into the building, and it was interesting as I went into the building on both sides. You can either enter on either one of the two streets that are on the sides of the courthouse. You can't enter in directly looking at the courthouse. The entrances are on both the right and left side of that particular building. And so when you go into the actual courthouse, on the outside, it says mask required, no entry, basically without mask. And so I looked at that and I was like, wow. I said, man, this is interesting. This is telling me that I cannot enter, no entry, mask required, and then you can't come in unless you have on a particular mask. Now, once you get in there, there's individuals, you know, that might have been vaccinated, things of that nature, so they might have a different determination once you're on the inside. But you can't even get on the inside of the building. You can't pass the sheriffs or go through the actual metal detector and things of that nature if you don't have a mask on. And so I thought about that. I said, man, this is interesting. Every single person who is going to enter into this building, and if they're inside the building for an extended period of time, they had to have on a mask. And in our lives, what this says here is that in order for us to enter into the kingdom of Almighty God, in order for us to have eternal life with Almighty God, Jesus says that the only way to enter is through him, that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one can come to the Father except through him or but by him. And so as a result, there's an aspect of where even in this dispensation, in this time frame in which we're living, where individuals will say no mask, no entry, mask required, and then you'll follow that particular guidance. We need to also understand that in order to even get into that courthouse, I had to put on a mask and be willing to walk in and follow the instructions of what it was that they were saying outside the building. For us to be able to get into the kingdom, we have to do what? Be able to follow the instructions that God has given us in his word. And the only way to get into the kingdom is through coming through he who is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's the individual that gives you right passage. He's the individual that gives you the invitation. He's the individual that grants you the authority. He's the one who is the great sacrifice. He's the individual that will bring you into right relationship with God the Father. Why? Because he's the Son, and he's been granted all authority to be able to judge. And so as a result, when we look at this, if you've accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, then when you go to the aspects of what's going to happen to you, as this scripture here defines, it says those who have done good will rise to experience eternal life. That means that even the dead will rise to have an aspect of where eternal life is what it is that they are being granted. Why? Because of what they did while during their temporal time to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And then it says here that even those who are dead and didn't accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior will rise, except their rising is going to be in a whole different way. They're going to rise what? They're going to rise because they continue to do evil and will rise to do what? To experience judgment. So whether you're good or you're bad, you're still going to rise based upon the message of what it is that Jesus is providing to his people. It's just that you're going to have either be, you're either going to go to the place of eternal life in heaven with God the Father, Jesus Christ, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, or you're going to go to the other place, which is eternal damnation, which is absence from God, eternal darkness, and then having experienced judgment because God is allow Jesus to have absolute authority to be able to judge every single person and every situation. So why wouldn't you try to get your life right with the judge? Because you're going to rise either way, but I'd rather rise and be right than rise and be wrong. So let's get here to verse 30. In verse 30, it says, I can do nothing on my own. I judge as God tells me. Therefore, my judgment is just because I carry out the will of the one who sent me, not my own will. Now, I want to share something with you quickly because this becomes something that's big that God will bless us to have a greater understanding regarding. When Jesus shares this, I can do nothing on my own, he's telling you that there's a level of relational connection and dependence that he still has with the Father. Because he's saying here, not that he's incapable, but he's saying that based upon a relationship that I have with the Father, that I will only judge in the way that the Father tells me to judge. See, there's a difference, and that's why God blesses Jesus to be the only one who will judge. See, many times we'll judge individuals out of our own opinions. We'll judge individuals out of our own brokenness. We'll judge individuals out of our wounding. We'll judge individuals out of our jealousy. We'll judge individuals maybe even out of hate. We'll judge individuals not with the love, that agape love that God wants us to be able to have towards each and every person. We'll judge individuals based upon levels of hurt that we've had. We'll judge individuals based upon precedents that might have been set by other people who were wrong when they set that precedent. So there's some things where we are fallible and we've done things that are counter. And so God says, listen, even in the aspect of judgment, my son is dependent upon me. Why? Because he says, I judge is what God tells me. See, so even in the aspect of when Jesus is providing his ultimate judgment, which is according to God's good and perfect will, when he provides his ultimate judgment, there's still a level of synergy. There's still a level of unity. There's still a level of congruence. There's still a level of approval. There's still a level of acceptance. There's still a level of them coming together, having a discussion. And the Father will say, Son, judge in this manner. And the Son will say, I will judge, Father, in the manner in which you prescribe, because I am doing your will, not my own. Why is it that when Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane and then his flesh is rising up and his flesh is telling him it does not want to drink of this cup of suffering, and then so he says, Father, not my will, but your will be done. This is letting us know that Jesus, even in the aspect of what happened in the Garden of Gethsemane, that Jesus in this regard is still being obedient, what, to the Father, because he's only judging in the manner in which the Father says to judge. And so that means that it's going to be perfect judgment. Why? Because there's no infallibility in Almighty God. There's nothing wrong in God. There's nothing that's evil in God. So it's going to be right. It's going to be just, and it's going to be fair. So then it says, I judge as God tells me. Therefore, my judgment is just because I carry out the will of the one who sent me, not my own will. See, when you're doing the will of God and you're doing things the way that God wants you to do them, you can stand with a level of confidence. You can stand with a level of firmness. You can stand with a level of really authority according to how God will bless. Why? Because you're not doing it on your own. You're not carrying out your own will. You're carrying out the will of the one who sent you. And in this regard, it's Jesus carrying out the will of God. Not his own will, but doing it in the manner in which God wants things to be done. That's why God doesn't leave the judgment of his people for eternal purposes to man who has a temporal existence, or to woman who has a temporal existence. In order to be able to have an eternal judgment, in order to be able to have a decision regarding eternal life or eternal death and separation from God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and the Holy Spirit, God sets it up so that Jesus is the only one that judges. That's why we shouldn't sit in the judgment seats. That's why when the judge says, when the bailiff says, all rise, here comes the judge, there's a huge peace in that. Why? Because we know that the greatest judge that God has ever created in Jesus Christ will judge us according to the will that the Father sets for him. That it won't be anything based upon discriminatory practices. That it won't be stuff based upon racism or sexism or whatever it is that it might be. Because we can go through the annals of all the things that have happened in the history of not just the United States, but the world, and the codification of various laws. And you will see that there were things that were put on the books that were counter to what God's word, will, and way actually is, where individuals were treated as 3/5 of a human being here in the United States, when it was redlining and other things that were meant to keep individuals out of certain areas, and they were codified in the law, that a judge sat in a seat and said that racism was okay, or separate but equal was okay, or whatever those things were, they were okay, or sexist behavior was okay, or denying a person whatever it is, that was okay. See, God says that the fallibility of man, the sinful nature of who we are, doesn't allow us to have the ability to make one of the greatest decisions that could ever happen, which is our ability to have eternal life with God the Father through Jesus Christ the Son. But however, we do get the opportunity to be able to tell Jesus how much it is that we love him, how much it is that we care for him, how much it is that we want to live for him when we accept him as Lord and Savior. That's when God uses Jesus Christ the Son to give us the truth. That's when he gives us the way. That's when he gives us the life that he wants us to be able to have, because he says, now come my daughter, come my son, come my child, be in right relationship with me, and now be in right relationship with my Father, and now I'm going to give you the power of the Holy Spirit that's going to reside on the inside and change your very life. This is why God wants everyone to rise. It also shares with us, and the Bible is very clear. It says that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that what? Jesus is Lord. Since Jesus is Lord over everything, and God here has told us that Jesus is the judge over everyone, then as a result, you need to be in right relationship with who? Jesus. Because you're going to say that he is Lord regardless of what you believe at the end of your days. Every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that what? Jesus is Lord, and God has already established that he is the one who will give us the eternal life-giving power to be able to rise again in him and have eternal life to be with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit for all of eternity. Man, I pray that you've been blessed. I love the aspects of when God blesses me to be able to share some stuff from a legal background and then just blesses it to also be tied in the scripture. I had an individual ask me the other day, you know, how did you become a pastor and an attorney? And I gave them a very short spiel. I said, man, you know, I was an attorney first, and the Lord blessed and called me into the ministry and things of that nature. But the one thing that I realized, and the two that I consider to be congruent callings, is that both tell you that you got to follow the law, that you have to do what the Bible says. And watch this. And when man's law contradicts God's law for me, I always say follow God's law first. So I really thank God that he blessed us with the opportunity to be able to be here this morning. I pray that you have an amazing Sunday. I pray that God blesses you and your family in a mighty way, and that he keeps you in everything that you do. So right now, I just want us to pray out as God will bless. Father, seal this teaching by the power of the Holy Spirit. God, I pray that we never sit in the seat of judgment. We leave that to Jesus, because he is the awesome, most amazing judge that could ever be. And so as a result, God, let us just live our lives in a way where we're not judging other people, God, but we are seeking to give them your word, your will, and your way to be able to have them come into right relationship with you. So, Father, bless everybody who may not be in right relationship with you, who might not believe in Jesus Christ, or, God, who just might have fallen off. God, give them the opportunity to have a restored relationship with you and to be brought back into the loving arms of our Father who loves us so much, Jesus who sacrificed so much, and the Holy Spirit who blesses us so much. So, Father, right now I ask that you just seal this teaching by the power of the Holy Spirit. Bless as only you can. Keep us as only you can. But most of all, God, love us as only you can. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. And real quick, I want to give a shout out to my boy Bees, my first friend, for his birthday on this Sunday. So happy birthday, Bees. God bless you guys and love you.